We love our police officers. We love our first responders, all of them.
Okay, this video is wild in more ways than one. And I'm going to prove to you in this video that Thin Blue Lives matter. In their minds, they matter more than you. As a matter of fact, in this video, I'm going to show you that your life doesn't matter at all. See on the screen right here, you're going to hear an Ohio trooper say, "I don't care about them." That is the people who just got into the accident with you, partner. "We care about you, Thin Blue Line Masonic gang member, but we don't care about them." And this video is going to show you that the system doesn't even care about the Thin Blue Line lives.
Well, tonight we're getting an up-close look at one family's nightmare.
This is a well-known family experiencing something all of us can relate to, concern for their teen driver. The Senate President Pro Tem and his wife, the Oklahoma County Clerk, got a terrible phone call January 5th. Their 16-year-old son had been in a catastrophic accident on the highway.
News 4's Allie Meyer sat down with the Treat family for an update on their son's recovery and some brand new details, and this shocking crash may lead to a new state law.
I-40 westbound at the mile marker 136 with a black Dodge Charger, no 28 available.
16-year-old Mason Treat is behind the wheel. That black Charger, a birthday gift for a new driver. He's on his way to basketball practice.
Warning, Deputy Mendoza, can I get the sheriff's office? The reason I stop you, you have no tag on your vehicle. Is there a reason for that?
Yes, sir.
The reason he was...
You don't have a tag on your vehicle, so you know I decided to pull you over while everybody else is doing 65, 70 miles an hour. I'm putting both of our lives in jeopardy. So you would think that the law that this dad, who's some kind of legislator, you think the law that he would propose would be a law to not pull people over on the side of the road and jeopardize their lives. At least that's what I thought he was going to do. Listen to this.
Pulled over is because didn't have the tag yet. And Oklahoma law allows for 2 months for that.
He's sitting in his car doing everything that he's supposed to do. You know, he rehearsed with us how to talk to the officer, where you put your hands, explaining, you know, here's my paperwork, I'm a legal driver. It should have been a simple conversation, and then he should have made it to basketball.
No, actually, there should have been no conversation. There should have been no cop pulling him over because he doesn't have a registration extortion fee metal plate on the back of his vehicle.
14 minutes after Deputy Jose Mendoza first pulled over Mason Treat.
Tell you what, I was going to give you a written warning for the license plate. I'm not even going to do that. I don't want that to show.
Now, I'm going to pause it right here. I'm going to advance it one more frame because YouTube is real squirrely. But I'll tell you what I will do. I will make sure if you want to see this without the edits, I will upload a video to my Twitter page. So just go to High Impact Flicks on Twitter and you can see that. So you can see right here in the left side of your screen, this is a truck with a trailer that's about to cream the back of this Charger right here, which is going to put the driver's life and the police officer's life in mortal jeopardy. So I've blurred everything out, YouTube screeners. You're not going to see anything bad, but the overarching deal here is that people are so cemented in cognitive dissonance and they have such a great amount of Stockholm syndrome residing inside their hearts that they're going to support the Thin Blue Line, even though the Thin Blue Line puts their loved ones in jeopardy. Now, watch how little law enforcement cares about you and me and how they put their own lives on a pedestal.
A drowsy driver nearly killed them both. Deputy Mendoza's dash camera continues to roll. It takes the injured deputy more than a minute to reach for his radio and call for help. Another 2 minutes before help arrives. An OHP trooper scans the deputy for injuries. Turns out they are neighbors and friends.
Is your leg okay? I don't care about that.
Mendoza asks, are they okay? Talking probably about the 16-year-old driver. And this OHP trooper says, oh, I don't care about them. I care about you, buddy. You know, they can suffer for a little while longer. And watch how long they make this 16-year-old suffer.
3.5 minutes pass another trooper arrives.
One of them hit him.
The deputy is seriously injured, but no one has checked on the other victims. No one is helping the teen boy trapped in his car. 6.5 minutes after the call came in, a Yukon police sergeant is the first to check on Mason Treat.
Can you imagine being the parent watching this dash camera video and being so infuriated and outraged that they put the life of your child on the back burner so that they could pay attention to the guy who basically was the catalyst for the accident? Yeah, this guy in the truck may have swerved over, but he wouldn't have hit any vehicles. He wouldn't have put two additional lives in jeopardy. Nobody's mentioning that in this news story.
He arrives at the Charger 8.5 minutes after the crash.
From having a child.
8.5 frickin' minutes that you could be rendering aid to somebody and helping to save their life. They don't. He literally, the OHP guy says, I don't care about them. I don't care. Not, we'll deal with them later. I don't care.
Approximately the same age, and I could tell he's young. I could tell from body behavior that it was pretty clear he had a pretty traumatic head injury.
Mason was unconscious, unresponsive, broken, and seizing.
I was angry when I realized the time gap. What if he would have survived the crash and wouldn't have survived those 10 minutes?
Yukon Fire pried Mason from the wreckage and carried him to an...
So basically the mom's saying, because of that eight minute lapse, my son could have died. But listen to how she maintains her love of the Thin Blue Line in spite of all this nonsense.
An ambulance, 24 minutes after impact.
We are so incredibly thankful for their service. My uncle's a sheriff, my grandfather's a retired police officer, my brother-in-law's a police officer, so we love our police officers. We love our first responders, all of them. And we count on all of them, very much so. And I think when there's a moment that you feel like they almost failed.
Almost. They did fail. The reason your son's alive is in spite of what the officers did or didn't do. Not because of. Your love for law enforcement in spite of this just shows your Stockholm syndrome, in my opinion.
It's hard to process because that's who we do count on.
Yeah, it's hard to process because that's called cognitive dissonance. You're trying to hold two mutually exclusive ideas at the same time, and you can't do it. So you just pacify your mind and smooth it over, even though you're trying to hold on to both. Number one, the first one is, they almost killed my son, damn it. My son almost died because of you, because you pulled him over, and then you didn't render aid. And the other idea, we love law enforcement. We love the boys in blue. We love our service members. We love them. Cognitive dissonance right there. So you got Stockholm syndrome. You got cognitive dissonance. And you got the cops saying, I don't care about your life. We care about our lives. And you got the system basically saying, we don't care about the driver's life. And we don't care about the Thin Blue Line member's life. So pull them over because we need you to generate revenue for the state. That's why we call them road pirates.
You know, that's who we count on when we can't be there and our little boy is trapped in a car. So it's hard.
I was trying to evaluate.
The Treat family is focused on gratitude for the sergeant who waited with their son in his darkest hour.
He was able to hold his hand and talk to him and be with him. And of course, we didn't know that till later. But there's just such a peace, you know, knowing, oh, somebody was there.
Somebody was there, and he was part of the same gang who decided to pull my son over and put his life in mortal jeopardy on the roadway. But at least he was there. At least the SS officer was there to hold my son's hand. At least the Gestapo member was there to make sure that he could comfort him in his darkest hour. Well, what about my son wouldn't have been there if the Gestapo wasn't in existence doing the crazy things that they were doing, putting people's lives in jeopardy?
Mason Treat spent 20 days in the hospital, 5 in ICU, first at OU Health, and then at Bethany Children's Center.
Put your butt down.
He's fighting a big fight that a lot of us wouldn't be strong enough to fight. And the fact that he couldn't walk, that he couldn't shower, that he couldn't do anything on his own, and now is wanting to go to car lots to look for a car. It's nothing short of a miracle.
I'm ready to drive. I want to go look at cars after this, actually.
Mason's parents are also ready to get to work fixing the confusion that led to that traffic stop on I-40.
There's
fixing the confusion. Here we go. What's the law he wants to change?
Discrepancy in the law I found since looking at it, and it unnecessarily puts the traveling public at risk and law enforcement. And so we're going to fix that. I will fix that this year.
The Senate pro tem is in his last legislative session. Mason was 4 years old when Dad got into politics, and Mom is just getting started in public life.
We're public servants. We want to fix things. And when we see something's broken, we want to try to fix it.
Yeah, you know what's broken? Traffic law is broken. Some adult thinking that he can make it's a childlike, nonsensical decision to pull somebody over in one of the most dangerous spots on the public roadways. Outside of the womb, outside of gun-free zones, one of the most dangerous places you can be is pulled over on the side of the road. And who is it that does that? Ironically, people who are supposed to serve and protect you. And they're the ones putting your lives in moral jeopardy.
We want to try to help people.
Making high-speed highways safer for Oklahoma drivers. Crafting the painful lesson of their son's experience into new rules of the road for all. Allie Meyer.
Now, let me show you the law that he wants to put into effect. It's not a law that says, hey, let's stop all this stupid traffic law stuff. It's a law that says, hey, let's change the license plate laws. It says the way the law is written now, anybody without a license plate is likely to be pulled over because there's no way to decipher between who is following the law and who's breaking law. How about we get rid of registration altogether? You already paid taxes when you got your vehicle. There's no sense in you paying taxes every single year after that. How about let's stop the extortion fee and let's stop traffic law? Says, to his credit, the deputy did nothing wrong. The deputy was just trying to do his job and enforce the law. Guess what? Just doing your job, just following orders and enforcing the law, almost cost your son his life. Doesn't that matter? He says, so if you and I have a private sale, so you and I transact and I sell you my car for 60 days, you could go completely without a tag and be completely compliant with Oklahoma law. That's what he wants to change. Treat has filed a bill that he hopes will help drivers and law enforcement. My bill will allow you almost instantaneously to get a metal tag and then give a temporary 10-day tag for those who buy from a dealership. It would allow private sales to be registered online, allowing an immediate notification that the car has been switched over. What if you got pulled over for another reason? Hey, your tag light wasn't illuminated properly. Hey, you didn't make a turn signal in a fair amount of time, so I'm pulling you over. I need to see your ID. Smash! Somebody rear-ends you. So he's not doing anything to solve the problem, and the problem is pulling somebody over and putting their lives at risk on the side of the road for a traffic violation. Aren't lives more valuable than traffic tickets? And I know what they're going to use as a justification. The reason we have traffic laws is because we're trying to keep the roadways safe. Pulling people on the side of the road going 0 miles per hour when thousands of other cars are zooming by at 60 to 70 miles an hour is not having regard for public safety. Leave your thoughts about this for the world and the Global Thought Police in the comments section below. If you haven't done so already, subscribe to the channel, hit the bell notification icon, give it a thumbs up, share it with everybody you know. If you haven't done so already, subscribe to my private email list through my website, highimpactflix.com. That's highimpactflix.com. If you want and you want to support the channel, grab one of these hard-hitting conversation-starting designs that you can put on a shirt, hoodie, mug, hat, cell phone case, whatever you want. We've got Road Pirates Violate Your Rights, protecting and serving the you-know-what out of you, and if a law is unjust, a man is not only right to disobey, he is obligated to do so. I got a whole lot more designs coming up. Check them out. But whatever you do, make sure you know what your rights are and you flex your rights. If you don't use your rights, you're going to lose them. Yeah, freedom is dangerous, but the only thing more dangerous is not having freedom. And I would way rather have dangerous freedom than peaceful slavery. I'll see you in the next video.